I popped it on up there. Okay, so we're moving into hormones. People at home, I'm gonna move you in just a second. Hormones is very difficult, okay? If anybody's ever dealt with endocrinology, it's difficult because we have different, and we're gonna go through all this. I'm just giving you a sort of once over first. We're gonna have the hypothalamus, okay? And the hypothalamus releases what are called releasing hormones. That hypothalamus is connected to what's called the pituitary. There are two parts to the pituitary that'll release hormones. There's the anterior and the posterior, okay? So the hypothalamus is either gonna create hormones that are stored in the pituitary, or it's gonna release what are called releasing hormones that talks to the anterior pituitary and tells it which hormones to release. Those hormones go to target tissues, those tissues release hormones, and then that travels through the blood, and then our hypothalamus is sensing what's going through the blood, and it'll say, well, we're low in this, or we're high in that. And either stop the release of the hormone or increase the release of it. So how many areas can hormones go wrong? One, two, at least three, right, within a circuit. If you have a brain tumor, if you have an aneurysm, right, if you have some sort of trauma, congenital anomaly, it can change this whole series of events. That's why endocrinology is like, bleh, it's very overwhelming, okay? But I think that if you could get a general working knowledge of all the endocrinological structures, it really helps you to sort of put it all together, okay? So, and the big thing is that series that I just told you, thinking of the hypothalamus as being the one that controls almost everything, okay? The anterior pituitary is gonna release a lot of hormones that will affect target tissues. That's a big thing. Because once you get to those target tissues, it's kind of easy, isn't it? Thyroid, what's the thyroid gonna do? Metabolisms, ovaries, progesterone, estrogen, right? It's kind of like the whole circuit that gets a little wonky. Well, the target tissues are hard too. Endocrinology is just hard, okay? So endocrine system, my people at home, I'm gonna bring you in, because what I would like to do is to, first of all, do a general overview of the general anatomy, okay? We're gonna talk about endocrine glands versus exocrine. Endocrine are gonna release hormones, okay? These are gonna be the glands that are gonna release hormones. And I'll give you the specifics of what they do and how they function in just another slide or two. Exocrine we'll talk about briefly. Exocrines secrete by a duct to a surface. Sweat, oil, tears, okay, are all gonna be exocrine glands. Part of the pancreas, believe it or not, is an exocrine gland, okay? So part of the liver is theoretically considered an exocrine gland. That's a philosophical statement, more or less, okay? So, but we're gonna deal with endocrine in this series. Now, endocrine is gonna release hormones. We understand that hormones are chemical messengers. They're chemical messengers that will change the function of the target organ, okay, or gland. Now, some cells can produce hormones too. Remember we talked about leukotrienes, prostaglandins, okay? So not only do we have hormones that are released from glands, we have hormones that can be released directly from cells. We'll talk about that as well, okay? And hormones are gonna affect a whole plethora of events, aren't they? Growth, reproduction, electrolytes, release of glucose, okay, metabolism, just tons of stuff. It's, we release like a tiny, tiny amount of hormones every day. Okay, enough that would feel like a teaspoon that regulates all of these functions. Now, when we talk, oh, I wanted to go over the structures too. Let me back up, sorry about that, okay? So, in the brain itself, now if you need a better picture of this, you could by all means just look this up on the internet for these glands. In the brain itself, the hypothalamus is going to be the big one that's going to regulate releasing hormones, okay? It'll go to the anterior pituitary. It also creates two hormones. We'll talk about that in a little bit. So the hypothalamus and the pituitary are going to be the two main structures that are going to release the majority of the hormones that are going to control our body, okay? In the back is the pineal gland. The pineal gland is kind of cool. It's considered our third eye. If you've ever gotten to pineal gland meditation, I actually have music for it. To release the spirit from the body is what people who are very spiritual believe, okay, the pineal gland. We as physiologists know that the pineal gland releases melatonin, okay? Melatonin is gonna regulate sleep-wake cycles. I think people consider a third eye, quote unquote, because it's a singular gland in the brain as opposed to being bilateral. So it looks like a third eye if you dissect the brain. If you were to pull the occipital lobe and the cerebellum apart and look at it, looks like a little third eye peeking out at you. So I think that's where that mystical kind of approach to it has come from, with it being the third eye, okay? The thyroid, I'm sorry, we know where the thyroid is, right? Anterior, the trachea, and the throat. I'm sure that we've got that basic exam down. Now, if you're looking at somebody who has, you know, their trachea exposed, if you're looking at a cadaver, okay, and they had their trachea or their thyroid exposed, you know, it looked like a little bow tie there. If you were to face it while you're facing them, take your fingers and pinch the backside of the thyroid, okay, and you would feel 4 to 6 little pea-like hard structures. Those are the parathyroids. Okay. Now the thyroid and the parathyroids are very intricate in calcium balance in the body. Very intricate, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. Okay. Thymus is behind the sternum. The thymus, we learned, creates T3, T4 cells. Okay. Or I'm sorry, T cells, not T3, T4. I'm getting my lectures mixed up. Okay, T cells, which help with immunity. That's where they're going to be created and released into the system, the thymus gland. The adrenal glands are going to be, I call them the little Napoleon hat that sits on top of the kidney. It looks like a little Napoleon hat when they draw it. It doesn't look like that in a human. It looks like a little glob of fat sitting on top of our kidneys. That adrenal gland is going to have the adrenal cortex on the outside. We're going to look at a picture of this in a little bit. And cortex always means the outside, right, when we're talking about an organ. Medulla is the center. So in the adrenal gland, we have the adrenal cortex and the adrenal medulla. Both of them sit like that little Napoleon hat on top of the kidneys. Okay. The pancreas, the head of the pancreas sits in the lap of the duodenum. That helps you to remember where it is. Do you remember where the duodenum is? Dun, 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 dun. The duodenum is the first part of the small intestines coming off of the stomach. Okay, I'll show you a picture of that in a little bit too. But the pancreas is going to span across underneath our stomach from the right to the left upper quadrants, believe it or not. It's pretty long. The head of it's going to be in the pancreas. The tail of it is right next to the spleen. So it's pretty long, little organ. Ovaries and testes, I think we're all pretty familiar with the location of those. Okay, so endocrine system, a general overview of their anatomy. So glands. When we're talking about endocrine and we're talking about exocrine, there's going to be microscopic structures that make them very different. There's also physiological functionings that make them very different. Okay? Endocrine is going to be a bunch of cells that are grouped together that are very close to a blood supply. And into that blood supply, they will secrete hormones. I know I keep hearing that too. There's something shifting in the back room. It is. There's a ghost in the room. Uh-oh. See, it's that pineal gland meditation that we're doing. It's a pineal gland meditation. Okay, so endocrine, that's what we're going to be talking about today. They do not have a duct by which they secrete their substances. They have blood vessels which are very intimately wrapped around them, into which they directly release their hormones, okay, or their chemical messengers. And then those hormones will travel through the blood to the target organ, okay? Exocrine, we're not going to talk about, but I just want you to know the difference. Exocrine is going to have a duct that secretes a substance to the surface. Like I said, tears, sweat, oils, okay? Excuse me. Hormones. So, this is where it starts to get all sorts of wonky. So, hormones. Specific chemical messengers for specific areas of the body. So we have hormones that can go systemic, or we have ones that'll be released locally, okay? And the ones that go systemic is all the different hormones that we're going to talk about in the next lecture, in this lecture, okay? They can be considered neuroendocrine because they're controlled by the nervous system as well as the endocrine system, okay? Neuroendocrine, because we have the hypothalamus and the pituitary controlling them. So we have nervous tissue controlling them. And then endocrine, because they're hormonal substances or chemical substances released into the blood. Okay. So neuroendocrine. We talked about the hypothalamus releasing those releasing hormones. So the hypothalamus isn't going to release hormones that'll be directly sent systemically. There are some that are stored, which we'll talk about in the future. But the hypothalamus is going to release releasing hormones, which talk to the anterior pituitary, which then release hormones out to the body. Okay, they're called, those are called tropic hormones when they're released out to the body. Oh, there it is there. Okay, so tropic hormones. When a hormone causes release of another hormone in a second endocrine gland, they're called tropic. Okay. So the job of that hormone is not to create a physiological change, it's to go to the target tissue and have that tissue release a hormone, which causes a change, okay? So it's second in line. Now, non-systemic, we're not gonna get into this a ton other than this little bit. We've actually talked about some of them, okay? There's paracrine, autocrine, and eicosanoids. I always have a hard time saying that, okay? So eicosanoids, just to go through this first, can be either autocrine or, well, actually, no, I should talk about paracrine and autocrine first. Paracrine is going to come from a cell and it's going to affect the cells immediately around it. So if there's an inflammatory response and there are some cell mediators released, it'll be released from those cells to the local cells right around it. But we can also have hormones that are released that'll affect the cell itself. Those are called autocrine. That pretty much makes sense, right? Because auto means self. So this happens with damage, when we have trauma, when we have inflammation, we have those chemical responses. We talked about leukotrienes, prostaglandins. Those types of hormones will be released locally and either affect the cells right around or the cells themselves, okay? So eicosanoids are gonna be a specific subgroup of this that can be autocrine or paracrine. They're going to consist of those leukotrienes and the prostaglandins that we spoke about earlier that are gonna deal with inflammatory processes, infections. They're gonna deal with contractions of smooth muscle. They actually have a plethora of effects, okay? These are gonna be very different from your thyroid hormone, from your growth hormone, okay? Because they're going to have a local effect as opposed to a systemic effect. Does that make sense? Go ahead. I want to look at something for a second. I want to jump ahead to this slide. This is just too ahead. So a hormone is released, and we'll learn about all these different hormones in this lecture, but a hormone is released, and it goes into the blood. So why is it that follicle-stimulating hormone, which creates sperm or helps the release of sperm and eggs, or the creation of sperm and the release of eggs, doesn't affect every cell of the body? Can anybody tell me why? I'm on the right track. So why, the question is, why is it if we release follicle-stimulating hormone, I know we don't know what that is yet, I'm telling you, it's gonna cause the creation of sperm in males and the release of an egg in a female, okay, follicle-stimulating hormone. Why doesn't it affect every cell of the body? There you go. Because the reproductive tissue is gonna have specific receptors for it. Some people call it a lock and key mechanism. That hormone, as it goes through the bloodstream, is only going to fit to specific receptors. Isn't that brilliant? Because if we release a hormone that affects every cell, well, we wouldn't exist, okay? Now, realize that there are some hormones that can affect multiple cells, so they'll have the receptors in multiple areas. Obviously, like look at like growth hormone. Okay, growth hormone is going to stimulate the growth in people, especially when they're young, for bones and skeleton to grow. A really good example that we all know is thyroid hormone, T3, T4, right? Because that's going to stimulate metabolism in multiple areas of the body. But the point is that there has to be target cell specificity. There's got to be receptors on those cells that will accept that hormone in order for that hormone to work on it, okay? So I was going to draw you guys a picture at home, but we remember those receptors, right? Do you remember those proteins in the cell? Okay. I see a yes, and I think I see a no. But if we're thinking about the plasma membrane or the cell membrane, okay, we've got all these protein channels that are invested in that cell membrane. Excuse me. Some of them are channels for ions or for larger substances to pass through. Some of them are receptors. Okay, some of them are receptors for hormones. So these hormones will come, well, there's two ways, I should say. Okay, there's two ways that we can send these signals in. Okay, but my point is, before we get into these two ways, is the cell has to be receptive. There has to be receptors that will let that substance in. Okay, so now we're at our cell membrane. I'm going to back us up one page while we're here, because we need to talk about the two major groupings of hormones. Amino-based, which is what? Out of our macronutrients, amino acid. Protein, okay? So these are gonna be protein-based or amino acid-based. And then we have steroid-based, okay? The steroid-based hormones, or the ones that mimic steroid-based hormones, are T3, T4, they are thyroid hormones, progesterone, estrogen, testosterone. Do I have those down there? I don't have those down there, do I? No. Okay, so steroid-based and thyroid hormone. Thyroid is actually amino acid-based, and for some reason it can get through, I think because of the size of it, I forget the biochemistry of that, I apologize. I'll look it up if you're really interested. But thyroid hormone can sneak directly through the cell membranes. Okay, that's what makes it so effective on multiple cells, right? Because it can sneak right through the cell membranes. So steroid-based and thyroid can sneak through the cell membranes. Steroid-based can sneak through the cell membranes too, because it's lipid-based. And our cell membranes basically are lipid-based. So they don't repel each other, okay? So those steroid hormones can sneak right through. So steroid hormones are gonna walk right up to the cell, say, knock, knock, I'm coming in. Amino acid base can't get through. They're too big, they're too complex. So instead of going right into the cell, they have to get attached to these receptors. I hope that's big enough for people at home. I'll start writing bigger. To receptors. It feels weird to write that big. Okay. Okay, gets attached to receptors, and it talks to what's called a second messenger. This gets into a whole new science unto itself, so this is as far as we're going to go with it. Okay, it talks to a second messenger. So amino acids are going to attach to the protein receptor, and then it's going to talk to a second messenger. Now, the second messenger can either be what's called a G-linked protein or a G-protein or a kinase. And a kinase is going to start a series of enzymatic reactions. Okay, so it's one or the other, depending on the hormone, depending on the cell that's affected. Okay, and I have that in there, right? Yeah, G proteins or kinases. Are you guys with me before I take this to the next level? Okay, so steroid gets in directly. Amino acids need to attach to the receptor, and it talks to a second messenger. Are you with me? Okay. Because taking it to the next step, once they get in, what do they do? What do they do once they get in? It's the big mystery. What do you think, what do our cells do? What's the primary job for all of our cells? I mean, other than just normal physiological functions. If they are growing, if they are making new cells, I shouldn't say new cells, if they're growing, what do they need to create? The whole premise with DNA is to either replicate a cell or create new proteins to replace and nourish the cells of our body. So DNA either creates new cells through mitosis, okay, remember that replication of daughter to daughter cells, or it creates new proteins. And those new proteins help to build our skin, our muscle, our bones, whatever it may be, according to that specific tissue, okay? So what this steroid does is it comes in and it directs directly talks to the nucleus and it tells that nucleus to make more proteins. Okay, and that would increase the physiological function of that cell. So if I were to go out and take a corticosteroid, so steroid-based are going to be, can I just put sex hormones? Okay, sex hormones, and I forgot, adrenal cortical. Okay, adrenal cortical hormones. The reason I remembered it is because corticosteroids are going to mimic these adrenal hormones, adrenal cortical hormones, okay? And they're all steroid-based. So back to what I was saying, if I want to bulk up and do a bodybuilding competition, okay, and I took synthetic steroids, corticosteroids, what would happen to my muscles? Well, they would bulk up, right? And it's because this corticosteroid derivative is going to sneak into those muscle cells and tell it to create more muscle fibers and make my muscles bigger, okay? Do you guys want to know what the whole negative is, why it eats away at the bone? Because it'll actually facilitate the release of those adrenal cortical hormones, which constantly undergo a process or create a process called gluconeogenesis, which starts to eat away at the tissues of your body. Have you ever heard of somebody getting a steroid shot and they have an avulsion, right? That's what happens. The steroid shot goes into that fiber and actually will eat away at the structures of that fiber. It's a process called gluconeogenesis. If you want to know what it is, come see me. I'm not going to get into it now. And it'll actually break down those protein fibers, okay? So there's upsides and there are downsides with steroids. I definitely think there's upsides with chronic pain to use it within a very good, you know, limited period of time. So anyway, back to the hormonal action. So steroids will go through that cell membrane and tell the nucleus to create more proteins, as opposed to the amino acids are gonna do what? Attached to a receptor, send a second messenger who's going to talk to who? Who's that second messenger going to talk to? It's not a trick question. It's the same thing as steroids. To the nucleus to create more proteins. So both of them will talk to the nucleus. The amino acid needs a second messenger. It can't fit through that cell membrane. Are you with me? That's kind of harder stuff, isn't it? Okay. Yes, no? Yeah, okay, good. Okay, anybody at home have questions? Let me know. So, let me make sure I just went through all this. So, steroid-based are gonna be from cholesterol, okay? That's the only other thing. There's the ghost. Ghost is banging on things today. Target cell specificity, we got that as well, okay? Control of hormone release can either be humoral. And this happens quite a bit because our hypothalamus is going to be constantly regulating and sensing the levels of hormones in our blood, okay? So, and we understand what humoral is. Humoral refers to blood. People used to think that that the humors of our body, you know, caused all diseases and carried our personality and whatnot. And so humoral is just sort of carried over to represent our blood. Okay, so humoral responses. Neural, sympathetic facilitation, and sympathetic's going to be relaxation or fight or flight. Sympathetic nervous system. Which is it gonna be? Sympathetic. Oh, we don't remember parasympathetic and sympathetic? Oh no. Should I review this? Okay, well, let's get through this slide and then I'll review autonomic nervous system. Okay, so neural fibers. So it's gonna be a direct stimulation from nerve fibers such as with the sympathetic nervous system and parasympathetic, which I'll tell you what they do in 2 seconds. I'll make it quick and easy, okay? So neural. And then hormonal is gonna be what's called tropic. It's where the release of one hormone stimulates the release of a second. That process is called tropic. So if you see tropic at the end of a name, it's going to mean that it is stimulating another gland to release a hormone, tropic, okay? Let's just quit, I can't stand it. We gotta review autonomic nervous system. Okay, we understand that there's two parts to the nervous system. There's voluntary and then there's involuntary. And in that involuntary nervous system, which is called, it's automatic, It's known as autonomic. I'm totally going off track right here. Autonomic is going to control all of the automatic processes in the body. Okay, breathing, respiration, release of hormones, you know, the menses cycle, everything. So autonomic nervous system. Autonomic is broken down into two parts, parasympathetic and sympathetic. I can't fit it in here. Sympathetic. Gosh, I hope you guys at home. So people at home, that's autonomic. On the left is that huge parasympathetic, which it's just, and then this is sympathetic. S-Y-M-P-A-T-H-E-T-I-C. Sympathetic. Okay. So parasympathetic is going to be all your D's. Diuresis, defecation, digestion. Okay. Sympathetic is going to be ease, excitement, exercise, embarrassment. Two R's? One R.
One.
So excitement, exercise, embarrassment. Parasympathetic is diuresis, defecation, digestion. And what happens in our body is we're constantly in a state of juggling between these two, okay? You go out, you run for 5 miles, who's gonna be more in charge? Sympathetic. You sit down for a big meal, you're nice and relaxed, who's gonna be in charge? Parasympathetic, predominantly. But then for the most part, it's kind of this balancing between the two so it doesn't get too out of whack, okay? Sympathetic nervous system, and this, I don't, you know, is going to be thoracolumbar outflow. If people have some sort of thoracic surgery, they can have damage to their sympathetic nervous system because it comes out at the thoracic and the lumbar spine. The outflow for parasympathetic is going to be what's called craniosacral. We're not going to get much into that. Craniosacral, okay? It's because that's where it comes out of the spine. The cranium and the sacrum, okay? And then those nerves go throughout the whole body. There's a lot more sympathetic than there is parasympathetic. They're gonna control vasoconstriction, vasodilation. They're gonna control the change of our pupils. They're gonna control sweating. They're gonna regulate where blood goes. If you've just eaten, it should go to the stomach. If you're working out, it should go to the muscles. So that's what these guys do. They're going to regulate all those autonomic functions. You may have heard of somebody going into sympathetic facilitation. Have you heard of that before? No? Okay. That's when somebody's sympathetic nervous system is overstimulated. And this could be overstimulated if you get nervous, right? And you get really nervous. You start to sweat. You get cold. You know, cold hands. It's that sympathetic nervous system. Okay. So autonomic, any questions on that? That is totally off track, just a little review of autonomic nervous system, very little review, okay? So endocrine hypofunction. So let me, people at home, let me bring you in. So the basic gist with endocrine system is we can have hypofunction or hyperfunction, one or the other, depending on what has physiologically changed or congenitally changed those glandular structures. So if there's agenesis, and A means what again? A means without. Okay, if there's agenesis, that'll be a problem. Okay, if somebody does not have those organs. Infection, tumor, infarction. I mean, I think all of this kind of makes sense. Autoimmune is a big one. Surgical removal. You know, if people have hyperthyroid, they have the thyroid removed, they may go into hypothyroid. Okay. Elevated levels of releasing hormones. So this is where it gets crazy. Now, what level can it be affected? Thyroid is tough because it can be affected at the hypothalamus, it can be affected at the anterior pituitary, or it could be the thyroid gland itself. Okay, so that's where it gets endocrine gets crazy. Hormone resistance is a problem too. Where do we see this? I'm sorry, I can't hear you. Insulin resistance is where we're seeing it. So what's happening with insulin resistance is, if you can imagine those receptors that I just drew on the board, and they're specific for insulin, okay? And insulin ferries glucose into the cells. That's its job. It helps facilitate moving glucose into the cells. So if those receptors are either decreased in number, okay, or deficient, we have what's called insulin resistance, where we can't ferry that glucose into the cell efficiently. Okay, and that's gonna be a big one that we're seeing. What are they linking insulin resistance with? I understand that can be like a hereditary problem, but for the most part, where do we see insulin resistance? Type 2 diabetes, but what has happened to them to promote this insulin resistance? Obesity, huge correlation with obesity. The increased level of triglycerides and overproduction of glucose or ingestion of glucose in the body decreases the effectiveness of getting the insulin, or those receptors of getting the insulin and the glucose into the cells. Okay. Oh God, I read like a 20-page explanation. I forget all of the, it has something to do with, you know, sort of a reaction between the fats and those receptors. I read through it once and I understood it, and to remember it was like, it was the same. Okay, so hormone resistance. So quite often seen in non-insulin dependent. We're gonna go through all that. Are we pretty good with insulin and non-insulin dependent diabetes? Seeing some yeses? Okay, good. So endocrine hyperfunction, obviously it's gonna be an increase in those tropic hormones. Generally it's going to be from neoplasia, but I would add on there too autoimmune, okay? I would add autoimmune on there as well. We could have some autoimmune functions, hyperfunctions, okay? Now, I also have there an increase in tropic hormones, but I would also add just an increase in hormones, in the hormones themselves, right? Because we can have adrenocortical hyperfunction, which is gonna be the hormone itself. So tropic hormones as well as hormones themselves. Okay, any questions so far? Okay, major endocrine organs. I'm going to decide if I want to stop here. We'll go a little bit more. Okay, major endocrine organs. I'm trying to make the tapes a little bit shorter because they've been like an hour long, so I want to shoot more for like 45 minutes, but let's try to get through those. So now we're going to go into the major endocrine organs themselves. Do you guys have any questions about that basic introduction to the microscopic issues in physiology? Okay. So the pituitary. Did I do a picture? I didn't do a picture of the pituitary. Oh my gosh, did I erase it? Hold on a second. I'm gonna look through. I'm wondering if I got bumped because I rewrote everything. Sorry, people at home. I hope I'm not making you dizzy. Look away. I'll let you know when you can look again. This is a huge lecture. Okay. You guys wanted more. I gave it to you. No, I'm just kidding. Okay. I can't believe that. It must have gotten... I had a little whoopsie where I thought I had erased this whole thing after I prepared it. Maybe I just lost some of it. Okay. So back to... Keep your eyes closed if I'm making you dizzy. I'm almost there. Pituitary. Okay. The pituitary gland. I'm going to pull up a quick picture. Pituitary gland. So the pituitary gland, here's a great picture. The pituitary, so we're looking at a mid-sagittal section through the brain. You can see the cerebellum's in the back, the nasal cavity is in the front. The pituitary gland sits in what's called the sella turcica, which means Turkish saddle. Okay. And just above it in the brain, they don't show it, but there's a very like, I don't wanna say nondescript, because when you dissect it out, it's pretty, you know, there's different nuclei that are specific to it. But just above it is going to be the hypothalamus. Now, connecting the two of them is going to be, let me see if I could get a picture of them together. Here we go. This is better, I think. Sort of, kind of. Okay, let me see if I could get a full-size picture. Okay, so people at home, I know you can't see really well when I'm far, so I'm not quite sure I'm going to pull you back out. Let me see if... Why is it doing that? Okay, never mind. I'm going to bring it closer. Okay, so you can see the hypothalamus, and you can see the pituitary, and there's a stalk in between them that's called the infundibulum. Okay, but you know what? Let me draw it. So you can see that picture there if you want to look along with that picture, but I would like to draw this for you. And draw is a relative term. So, if this is the brain, okay, we've got the cerebellum back here, so this is the front. We have the hypothalamus, which is just, like I said, sort of this nondescript little area, and it's connected by a stalk down to the pituitary. So hypothalamus, and it's called hypothalamus because it's right below the thalamus, and then we've got pituitary. Okay. And what they're connected by a stalk, which is called the infundibulum. Okay, the infundibulum. The pituitary sits in this really cool little bone shaped structure that looks just like a saddle. It's called sella turcica. That's right in the notes. And that means Turkish saddle. When you look at it, when you actually look at a skull and look at the inside, it looks like a little saddle. It's pretty cool. Okay. So the pituitary is going to sit right in there. Now what happens is there are two parts to the pituitary. There's posterior pituitary, which we're going to go over all of this. I just want to give you a visual. Posterior pituitary, and then there's anterior pituitary. Okay? And of course, anterior is going to be towards the front, you know, it's the majority of it. Posterior is towards the back. Are you with me? Okay. And they're connected to that hypothalamus by that infundibulum because they're so intricately related. They need to have that close of a connection. Okay? So, coming back to the notes here. Site. Okay, so sits in the cella turcica. It releases 9 hormones. I'm going to go through all those with you. I did lose some of this lecture. Okay, well, I'll make it up as we go along. Okay, so 9 hormones connected by that stalk. There's an anterior, there's a posterior part. The anterior part is made of closely packed cells called epithelium. Okay. The back is actually derived from part of the brain. It's nervous tissue. Okay, so the anterior is going to be just closely packed cells called epithelium. The back is going to be nervous tissue. Are you with me? Okay. The anterior is going to create 7 different types of hormones. The posterior does not create hormones, it stores hormones. So the hypothalamus is going to make oxytocin and ADH. Oh, there it is. Okay, I was looking for something there. Okay, so the posterior pituitary is going to store that oxytocin and ADH. So the hypothalamus makes oxytocin and ADH. That's right at the bottom part of that pituitary, aka hypophysis. Okay, are you with me now? Okay, and I'm talking about the anterior pituitary and the posterior pituitary. Okay. So the anterior pituitary is made up of epithelium or closely packed cells. It makes 7 hormones. And the mnemonic for that is flat pag. I'll write them up on the board in just a second. Okay. The posterior pituitary makes no hormones whatsoever. It gathers oxytocin and ADH from the hypothalamus, and it stores it in little vesicles. On another word for pituitary is hypophysis. I don't know if you would ever hear this clinically or not, but adenohypophysis is another word for the anterior pituitary. Neurohypophysis is another word for the posterior pituitary. And it refers to the tissue that makes it. Okay, neurohypophysis is going to be nerve tissue. Adeno always references that epithelium or closely packed cells. Okay, so adenohypophysis. I don't know, would people use, have you heard of anybody use that term clinically, adenohypophysis and neuro? Okay, good. So I think that would be a good thing to know. Okay, adenohypophysis and neurohypophysis. Okay. So anterior pituitary is going to release the flat peg hormones. Okay, flat peg hormones. That's the mnemonic. Trying to write big for the people at home. So follicle, and we're going to go through all these. Stimulating hormone. I'm just going to put H for hormone. I always spell this wrong. Luteinizing hormone. So if I spelled it wrong, sorry. It's just, one of those words I just can't remember. Adrenocorticotropic hormone. ACTH, sound more familiar? And that's what I'll call it. And then thyroid stimulating hormone. Or thyrotropic stimulating hormone, okay? And then P is prolactin. E is endorphins, which can be used as a stimulant, as that kind of runner's high, but it also can be used as a neurotransmitter. We're not going to get into it, but endorphins, and it, well, yeah, it, there's more to it, but okay. And then G is growth hormone, which we all kind of know, right? So I'm going to put GH, growth hormone. So follicle stimulating hormone, luteinizing hormone, ACTH, thyroid stimulating hormone, prolactin, endorphins, and growth hormone is GH, flat peg. It's an I used to have the hardest time remembering all of the hormones until I memorized this for the, yeah, flat peg. So that way it just, you know, if I was kind of trying to figure out what the precursor was to stimulate like the ovaries, you know, I'd remember that flat peg and it really triggered a lot for me. Okay, so flat peg. Anterior pituitary hormones. Okay, so what happens with the adenohypophyseal hormones or the anterior pituitary is the hypothalamus is going to stimulate that anterior pituitary and it can release any of those hormones that we've talked about. Okay, okay. Growth hormone is, I'm going to kind of buzz through these because I think these are pretty commonsensical. Okay, growth hormone is going to target bone and muscle to cause growth. It also will decrease the use of glucose and increase the lipolysis or the breakdown of fat for energy. So guess what people are starting to use this for now? To lose weight and to build skeletal muscle and bone, okay? I think that the negative with this is it can promote certain types of cancers. I think that's what it is. So it's going to be stimulated by, and I have this for each one of these, but you know we won't keep going over them because it makes sense. Oh, people at home, let me bring you in. Okay, so we're on, there we go. Growth hormone, it targets bones and skeletal muscles, promotes protein synthesis, use of fats for fuel. Stimulated by growth hormone, releasing hormone, which is gonna be released from the hypothalamus, and inhibited by, once again from the hypothalamus, growth hormone inhibiting hormone. Okay. Thyroid stimulating hormone, TSH, I think you probably recognize it as, right? Because if they do a thyroid panel, they need to check all the different levels of it. Okay, obviously stimulates the thyroid. We're going to get into the thyroid as its own separate animal. Animal, it sounds funny. Okay, thyrotropic releasing hormone from the hypothalamus, release the anterior pituitary, blocked by growth hormone inhibiting hormone. So it's a little bit of a different thing there. And I'm kind of going quickly because this all makes sense, right? Okay, what these do, stop me if they don't. ACTH, this we're getting into as its own separate animal as well. Stimulates the adrenal cortex to respond to stressors in the body. Corticotropin releasing hormone from the hypothalamus. gonadotropins are going to be both follicle-stimulating and luteinizing hormone. Now, follicle-stimulating is going to help the release of eggs and sperm. Luteinizing is going to regulate the release of gonadal hormones, okay? So progesterone, estrogen, and testosterone, which we all have. We all have those three. In females, progesterone and estrogen will be more predominant, okay? And in males, testosterone will be more predominant or prevalent, okay? Unless there's problems. And that's when we start to see more feminization or masculinization in people. I just saw somebody yesterday at a follow-up CAT scan, and there's no inflammation, so I'm doing good, okay? Yay. But there was a woman there who was definitely, yeah, and not just a shadow. I mean, yeah. So, you know, we can have a decrease in those female hormones, which would make that testosterone in, you know, in perspective, be more predominant and cause more male features, okay? So luteinizing hormone is going to help to release all of those three sex hormones, okay?
My brother had testicular cancer. One of the markers they looked for was abnormal level of FSH. I guess
yeah. So there are abnormal levels of FSH in one of the students' brothers-in-law, did you say?
It's my brother who had testicular
cancer. And he had testicular cancer. And why that happens is because there's going to be an abnormal release of testosterone from the testicle, because that's where we get testosterone itself. I'll talk to you about where that comes from. So that abnormal release goes up to the brain and will actually change the levels of that luteinizing hormone. Yeah, that's great. So all these things are definitely clinically applicable. Prolactin is going to stimulate milk production. Oxytocin, guys, is what stimulates the letdown reflex. And it also stimulates what's called the cuddle reflex, postcoital, as well as post-breastfeeding. Okay? So kind of an interesting little thing. So it may produce a little bit of testosterone in males. So once again, prolactin releasing hormone, prolactin inhibiting hormone, those all make pretty much sense, right? Except for one or two exceptions. Posterior pituitary, and here it is. Antidiuretic hormone is obviously gonna stop what? Diuresis, okay? Oxytocin. So oxytocin, I would add in there, is your letdown reflex. And we know what that is, I'm just assuming. Okay, milk letdown. So when a female gets pregnant, I'm just going to go over this. I'm sure everybody knows it, but when a female gets pregnant, she'll release prolactin, and prolactin is going to create the milk, and it'll be stored in ducts that are higher up in her breast. And then there are sinuses, which are closer to the nipple, that the milk needs to be let down into in order for it to be suckled by the infant. So prolactin will create it. It's stored in the ducts that are higher. Oxytocin is that wonderful letdown reflex if you've had kids and you're out shopping and you just had your baby and you hear somebody else's baby crying and all of a sudden you got to leave your shopping event because you've just let down your milk. That's what's happened. Oxytocin, yeah, I can always tell who's had kids and who hasn't. oxytocin kicks in. We let down the milk, so we're able to feed our infant, okay? But, like I said, it's also known as the cuddle hormone. It's a very strong correlator between a bond between people, mother, infant, as well as partners, okay? They've found it to be in high levels postcoital and also after nursing. So it's a pretty cool little hormone there, that oxytocin. It also helps with delivery, contraction of that smooth muscle. Okay, oxytocin will help with those contractions as well. Okay, kind of cool little stuff. Adenohypophyseal dysfunction. Okay, so you know what? I think at this point, let's just push through. Okay, so growth hormone hypersecretion is going to. So oversecretion before the growth plates close. So in females, our growth plates are gonna close when we're approximately 18 years old, okay? And we understand what happens when the growth plates close, right? We're gonna stop growing. Growth plates are plates that cause a little separation in the ends of our lung bones so we can keep depositing bone. Then eventually when they fuse, we will stop growing in height. We can grow wider, but we won't grow taller. Okay? And 18 is a guesstimate. I mean, mine didn't grow until I was 20 because I grew an inch or two in college, but you know, as an estimate, males will close at 20. So if there's an oversecretion of growth hormone in somebody whose growth plates are not closed, you can get giantism, okay? Which means they will be very, very tall. They could be 8 to 9 feet tall. They'll have very long fingers, okay? Yeah, because those are long bones as well, okay? And they can also have heart defects with that. Acromegaly is going to be the oversecretion of growth hormone that will be seen after the growth plates close. And so what happens is the bones get thicker and people's faces can start to look more masculine if they're female. Okay, I think I have a picture a little bit further along with that. Okay, hyposecretion, panhypopituitarism is due to metastatic or infection. Okay, causes hypoactivity of glands. Sheehan syndrome, this was in your book. I've never heard of this before, but it was kind of interesting. Compression of the blood supply to the anterior pituitary during pregnancy. Interestingly enough, okay? And it can cause a decrease in release of prolactin. I've never heard it before. If anybody's heard of it or seen it, let me know. But it was one of those things that I looked at and I thought, well, maybe they'll see it again at some point. I mean, not necessarily from me, but okay. So neurohypophyseal dysfunction. So diabetes insipidus. Diabetes insipidus is when we're going to have a lesion to the posterior pituitary, quite often post-trauma, post-head trauma, right? Like a whiplash, car accident, some sort of things like that. Causes a shearing, causes damage to that posterior pituitary. It can't release antidiuretic hormone. So what's the sign and symptom going to be initially with that patient? That's a big one. A lot of PN, right? They're not going to be releasing antidiuretic hormone. They're going to release all the water out of their kidneys. We're not going to reabsorb it, right? If they're losing that water, you're going to start to get electrolyte imbalances, aren't you? Your solution is not going to be isotonic anymore, okay? And they'll be very, very thirsty. So this could be mistaken for what? Diabetes mellitus, right? Obviously. So if you have somebody who has these signs and symptoms and you take a blood test and their glucose is normal and they have a head trauma, but quite often with people like this, they're going to have a head trauma. You know, they're going to be coming in with some sort of head trauma, okay, that's affected them. Symptom of inappropriate antidiuretic secretion is going to be excessive secretion of ADH. They're going to retain all sorts of fluid, and once again, their electrolytes are going to be off because in relativity, if they're retaining all of their fluid, when you're looking at one segment, you're actually going to have a hyponatremia. Are you with me? Even though sodium levels may be normal, you're going to have so much fluid, it's going to be diluted, okay, and a hypokalemia as well, okay? Okay? Let's take a break now, and we'll start up with thyroid gland in about 5 minutes, okay?